Jesus took our curse and was made a curse so that we may have blessings. Jesus took our poverty so that we may enjoy his abundance. Jesus took our shame so that we may have glory. Jesus took our rejection so that we may have God's complete acceptance.
So here I am to worship. Here I am to bow. Here I am to say, you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Oh, here I am to worship. Here I am to bow. Here I am to say, you're my God. You're all together love, all together worth, all together.
Did you know there's a New Testament within the Old Testament? They're referring to Isaiah 42:66. How can they do that? Listen to this now. The 27 chapters are like the 27 books of the New Testament, right? The 27 chapters of Isaiah are further divided into three divisions. Now, when people outline Bibles, you know, outline books of the Bibles, chapters of the Bibles, and so on, for study purposes, you know, they look at a thought and they go till where that particular passage, they see where it ends. That thought ends and a new thought begins. So they outline it like that. So those who outline it say that 27 chapters can be divided into three divisions of 9 chapters each. One extraordinary feature of the 9 chapters each is each of the ending verse, that is, 9 chapters each means from 40 to 48 is the first division, chapters 40 to 48, and then 49 to 57 is the second division, to 57 is the second division, and then 58 to 66 is the third division of 9 chapters. The thing that divides them, or the most extraordinary thing about these 9 chapter division, is at the end of each 9 chapters, the last verse of the 9th chapter in all three divisions, there is a verse that sounds very similar that basically indicates that God will not compromise with sin. Sin has to be dealt with. God will never ever compromise with sin. Let me just read to you those verses. 48, last verse, verse 22. There is no peace, says the Lord, for the wicked. That's the last verse. There is no peace, says the Lord, for the wicked. That means God is merciful, but he's not going to put up with the wicked. He's not going to, you know, even though he's merciful, it doesn't mean that he overlooks sin. He compromises with sin. No, he will do something about sin. He will deal with sin properly and legally. He cannot just overlook sin. 57th chapter is the next division. The last verse, verse 21. There is no peace, says my God, for the wicked. Again, the same thing. This is how they divide the chapters. And then 66th chapter, last verse. They shall go forth and look upon the corpses of men who have transgressed against me, for their worm does not die and their fire is not quenched. They shall be an abhorrence to all flesh. Talks about what will happen to the wicked at the end if they remain wicked. So it's basically the same thing, that God does not and will not compromise with sin. Sin has to be dealt with properly. That's the theme, right? So 9 chapter divisions. Now, if there are 3 9 chapters within the 27 chapters, then what is the center of the 3 9 chapters? The middle 9 chapters, right? The middle 9 chapters is what? The middle 9 chapters is chapters 49 to 57 is the middle 9 chapters. That's the center of the 27 chapters. Divided, 27 chapters divided into 9 chapters each, three divisions. The center, the middle one is chapters 49 to 57. That is the center of the 27 chapters. Now, what is the center of these 9 chapters? 49 to 57 has 9 chapters. What is the center? 49, 50, 51, 52, then 53 is the fifth. Then 54, 55, 56, 57. Again, 4 chapters are coming. So 4 chapters this way and 4 chapters that way. In the middle is 53, chapter 53. So I say to you, the middle 9 chapters is the center, and out of that, the 53rd chapter is the very center of the middle 9 chapters. And now, 53rd chapter, they say, begins actually in 52nd chapter, verse 13. If 53rd chapter is about the suffering of the Messiah, the suffering of the servant of God, as he is called here, then the suffering passage begins, the prophecy about his suffering begins in verse 13. In 52nd chapter, it begins like this, 52:13. Behold, my servant shall deal prudently. He shall be exalted and extolled and be very high. Just as many were astonished at you, so his visage was marred more than any man, and his form more than the sons of men. So shall he sprinkle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths at him. For what had not been told, them they shall see, and what they had not heard, they shall consider. So the suffering begins back in verse 13 of 52nd chapter itself. The sin-bearing servant topic begins in 52nd chapter, verse 13, and goes on through 53rd chapter. So all the people who interpret the Isaiah have basically agreed that the chapter is beginning at the wrong place here, as they have divided. Men divided the chapters later on, you see. So they have divided it wrong, they say. It must begin in verse 13 of 52. So if it begins in verse 13 of 52, they again divide those verses into groups. They outline those verses. And they come up with 5 groups of 3 verses each. First group is chapter 52, verse 13 to 15. Second group is chapter 53, verse 1 to 3. Third group is verses 4 to 6 of chapter 53. Fourth group is verses 7 to 9 of 53. And fifth group is 10 to 12 of 53. Now 5 groups are there of 3 verses. What is the middle one of this? Is Isaiah 4 to 6. I don't know how this happened, but many people have discovered it. They are pointing it out. They say this seems to have been done by divine ordination. God takes the New Testament within the Old Testament and puts right at the center of it, at the dead center, at the very center of it, Isaiah 53, verse 4 to 6, which is specifically about Christ hanging on the cross and what happened to him as he hung on that cross. What God did through that. All the other verses are related to his sufferings and so on. But 4 to 6 is exactly about his suffering on the cross, indicating that in the gospel, the cross is at the very center of the gospel. It deserves no other place other than the very center of the gospel. If you take it out from the center, you're lost. Right? So now look at Isaiah 53, verse 4 to 6. This is what we read. When we read, you didn't realize it was at the dead center of the gospel, that this message, verse 4 to 6, carries the message that is the centrality of the gospel that we preach. So let's read verse 4 to 6 and look at how it begins. Surely is the word. It is not used anywhere in that whole thing. Surely. Everybody say surely. God knew very well back then there'll be scholars that will be raised up in the last days that will say, no, don't believe that. It can't be saying that. This is not true. So God back then said, especially when he got to verse 4, he said, surely, surely, everybody say surely. You know how many places they have now removed the word blood from their hymns? From their vocabulary, because they think it is not modern enough to accommodate in the church, that we are a modern people, that we shouldn't be talking about the blood of Jesus, that it looks ugly, and that doesn't give a good picture of Christianity. These people are trying to give a good picture of Christianity. They are saviors, you know, trying to save Christianity from shame and disgrace. They say, let's remove the word blood. The blood of Jesus and all that, the blood shed and all. Let's, if possible, remove the cross itself, you know. And make it like a fancy little thing. So many songs have changed. The blood subject is removed from the songs. Preaching is almost extinct in most places concerning the blood of Jesus. And that is why there is no power to change anybody. Because God has put the power right there. That's the centrality of the gospel. You take this out, there is nothing. Then you're sermonizing. Your nice thoughts don't change anybody. Your nice thoughts tickle ears, but it does not do anything for anybody. It has no power to change people. It has no power to change the hearts of people. It has no power to wash a sinner's sins. It has no power to bring a new heart to a man. New birth to a person. It is so important. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. The two Hebrew words that are translated griefs and sorrows are all, at all other places in the Old Testament, the same two Hebrew words are only translated as sickness and pains. Only here it is translated as griefs and sorrows. Totally misguiding, misleading people away from the healing. Because of this, a lot of people thought healing is not there. They have lost out a great blessing that comes through the cross of Calvary because of this one thing. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. Notice the subject of sin is here. He was wounded for our transgressions, our sins. He was bruised for our iniquities. The subject matter of sin is here. How sin is remedied is what the subject is about. He was wounded for our transgression, bruised for our iniquities, because sin must be punished. God's law says the soul that sins shall die. That's what was happening on the cross of Calvary. Why did Jesus die? Even though he was sinless, he never did one sin. There was not even sin by birth in him. All of us carry sin from birth. He never even had that. Why did he die? Because verse 5 says he was wounded for our transgression. He was bruised for our iniquities. Not that he couldn't save himself. He was offering himself as a sacrifice for us on the cross of Calvary. He was wounded for our transgressions, bruised for it. He was solving the most difficult problem of humanity, the problem of sin. He was offering himself as a sacrifice. Then verse 6, all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Look at verse 6. It states very beautifully the problem of sin. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. Many, many years ago, there was a preacher, singer in America called Frank Sinatra. Some of you may know. He came up with he sang a song. I don't know if he wrote it or not, but he sang a song that I used to like back in those days. It said, I did it my way. I did it my way. A single record was made. One song on a record sold more than 1 million copies back then. One song, people would go and buy one song record to hear that. And they'll play it again and again. I did it my way, you know. I used to hear that also, you know. Now I look back on it and think, what was in it? There's nothing. He's singing, I did it my way. And we all loved it because we all belonged to that bunch that did it our way. We were all gone astray. We were all sinners. We all went astray. We were all people that did things our way. That was our, that is sin. What is sin? No place for God. What is sin? Not living for the glory of God. We do it our way. We loved it because that's the way we lived. You ask people, say, don't do it that way because the Bible said, forget about the Bible, man. It's my money. I earn it. I'll do whatever I want with it. It's my legs, my hands. I'll do what I want with it. Who cares, you know? That's the way. That's the my way thing. My way is the highway. Is my way is the best way, you know. That's the way people live. That is sin. That is what Bible describes as sin. They don't realize that God brought them into the world. God gave them life. We dedicated a child. How did the child come into the world? God gives the children. Children are a heritage of the Lord. He has given the breath of life, brought them into the world, put treasures inside of them, talents and gifts, for a purpose. How can you just live your way? You must, if you really understand all these things, you'll say, God, which way should I go? You know. But the thing is, verse 6 says, all we like sheep have gone astray, loitering, going about here and there, but going nowhere, you know. And I've also tried it back when I was young. For a while I was going around just here and there, no purpose. I remember spend hours together just talking to these guys, stand there and talk and laugh and, you know. some of these preachers will come and say, oh, Sam, how are you? What are you doing here? Just simply we are standing here. Simply. I couldn't tell any purpose for standing there doing the things. For hours, one whole evening will go. 6 o'clock, we'll get together, 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock, you know, just going, you know. Those days we never had cell phone, but we could tell where anybody will be. We'll go pick up our friends and say, no, no, he won't be there. I'll tell you, he's there. We were like prophets, you know, we were led. We were led by the Spirit. No messaging, no phones, nothing. But we could go catch a fellow where he is, exactly. We'll catch him exactly where he'll be, you know. Those were the days. No phone bills for a change. But that's not a good life because that's a wasted life. Every day we lived like that, we went nowhere, wasted hours and hours. I wish I had just sat down and did something, you know, productive. I never did it. I could have learned something. I could have read something. I could have, you know, understood many things. But I never thought. I never thought there was anything to read and understand and learn those days. I never had a purpose. I didn't know why I was here, why I was born, what God has given to me, that I'm answerable to God. There is a God who is a creator. I'm just a creature. That every day I must seek His will. I never thought that. That's the condition of a sinner who's lost. He's lost. That's why he's loitering. In life, he goes about just like this, here and there, astray, not knowing what to do. When you get saved, the one thing that happens is you get hooked up with your Maker, and He gives you direction. Instead of being pointless in your direction, you become very well-directed. Every day you get up with a vision. Your life is filled with a vision. You go about doing certain things exactly as you must do it and live it fruitfully. Amen? Amen. All right. So, and finally it says, the Lord has laid on Him the iniquity of us all. The word iniquity comes from a Hebrew word, avon. The iniquity does not mean just the sin or the transgression. The word transgression is also used. But it does not mean just the things that the guy did, the wrong things that the guy did. It includes the punishment for those things as well as the consequences of those things. the punishment and the consequences of those things. Let me read chapter 4 of Genesis. After Cain killed his brother Abel, God comes to him and asks him, where is Abel, your brother, and so on, right? And then verse 10, God says, now what have you done? The voice of your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground, so now you are cursed from the earth. See, God knows that he has killed, that killing is a sin, murder is what he has done, right? But look at the consequences and the punishment that comes for that murder. You're now cursed from the earth, which has opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. So you're cursed from the earth. When you till the ground, it shall no longer yield its strength to you. Now that's very sad because this guy is a farmer. He's a farmer and he cannot even go and plant something and get some crop. That's very sad. That means you can't earn. You know, you go and work and work and work, you earn very little. That's not enough to even fill your stomach. He says, you're cursed from the earth, and then when you till the ground, it shall no longer yield its strength to you. A fugitive and a vagabond you shall be on the earth. That is, fugitive and a vagabond means an unstable person loitering around, astray, just going around, you know, purposely, aimlessly, just going about. So that's the punishment. The punishment is in the work. See how sin affects the prosperity of a person. He works, there is no fruit. There is no blessing. There is no purpose in life. There is no happiness. There is no sense of satisfaction or fulfillment. These are all consequences. Why I read this is the word avon, which is translated iniquity in verse 6 of chapter 53 in Isaiah, includes not only the iniquity, but also the consequences and the punishment. So when it says the Lord laid on him, Jesus, the iniquity of us all, does not mean just our transgression or our sin. It means also the punishment for that sin, as well as the horrible, cruel consequences of that sin. For example, in Cain's case, it is his murder. The guilt of that murder was laid upon Jesus. But then his cursedness, where he will work and yield no fruit, that curse was laid upon Jesus. His life as a vagabond, that was laid upon Jesus. So when Jesus hung there, God laid upon him the iniquity, meaning the sin as well as the consequences and as well as its punishment, burdened him with all of that. And he carried that on the cross of Calvary. So as a result, some wonderful exchange happened. What has happened? It's not a one-way street. It is not just God laying on Jesus all kinds of bad stuff. The good stuff that was on Jesus was taken and put on us. There was a two-way exchange. He has borne our griefs, carried our sorrows. That's God putting that on him. And then in verse 5 it says, he was wounded for our transgression, bruised for iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was laid upon him. That is again God putting more stuff, bad stuff from us on him. But then listen, it's a two-way thing. After he puts all our bad stuff, then he takes from him and puts it on us. He says, and by his stripes we are healed. He took all our stuff and put it on him. And then from his stripes comes healing to us. And then verse 6 says, the Lord has laid upon him the iniquity of us all. So I would say it like this. The cross was a place of exchange where God exchanged everything that was good in Jesus for everything that was bad in us. Jesus was punished so that I might be forgiven. We might be forgiven. Jesus was wounded so that we might be healed. Jesus was made sin with sinfulness so that we may be made righteousness. Jesus took our death so that we may have his life. Jesus took our curse and we was made a curse so that we may have blessings. Jesus took our poverty so that we may enjoy his abundance. Jesus took our shame so that we may have glory. Jesus took our rejection so that we may have God's complete acceptance.
This is the season of Jubilee.
This is the season of Jubilee.
singing and dancing for you and me.
Singing and dancing for you and me.
Thanking and praising because we're free.
Thanking and praising because we're free.
Oh, this is the year of Jubilee.
Oh, this is the year of Jubilee.
Put your hands together. Everybody praise the Lord. Put your hands together. Sing, shout, and praise the Lord. This is the season of Jubilee.
This is the season of Jubilee.
Singing and dancing for you and me.
Singing and dancing for you and me.
Thanking and praising because we're free.
Thanking and praising because we're free.
Oh, this is the year of Jubilee.
Oh, this is the year of Jubilee.
Put your hands together. Everybody praise the Lord. Put your hands together. Sing and shout and praise the Lord. Everything that was stolen shall be returned unto me. Mother, father, sister, brother, they will all go free. Everything that was stolen shall be returned unto me. Singing, dancing, praising, shouting, increase in victory. Sing that again. Everything that was stolen shall be returned unto me. Mother, father, sister, brother, they will all go free. Everything that was stolen shall be returned unto me. Sing, dancing, praising, shouting, increase in victory. Shall be returned unto me. Mother, father, sister, brother, they will all go free. Everything that was stolen shall be returned unto me. Sing, dancing, praising, shouting, increase in victory. This is the season of Jubilee.